scene that you're no longer happy. Or that you have okay. to see them.
Good to know. I'd say every slur I know in alphabetical order.
So right now, by the way, this is the first bite that I will have knowledge, like that I know I'm trying shepherd's pie. I don't remember ever eating this because the mashed potatoes are a huge texture thing for me. This is kind of a thing on the podcast.
Do you hate potatoes?
Mashed potatoes.
Oh my God, I wouldn't have.
No, this is this is why I didn't say anything.
Oh my God.
So you know what? Erin Matthews, welcome to the podcast.
Yay!
Shepherd's pie. Here we go.
Okay. I hope you throw up on your equipment.
That's just potato. I gotta get...
You have to get the good shit in there.
I was gonna say, do you have meat in yours?
Yeah.
Okay.
This
might be just potatoes over here on mine.
Are you gonna... Do you want to switch?
Nope, I don't like mashed potatoes.
Really, really glad that we did this. I'll see you next time.
Yeah, the science is done a minute in.
I'm so sorry.
No, don't, because this is part of the fun where, like, I still get to make the meal for a friend and catch up and, like...
Oh, my God.
I get to hear all about love shepherd's pie. I mean, I still love to cook. It doesn't matter what I'm cooking.
That sucks you don't like it, because I think you seasoned it like super well.
It is good.
Yeah. It's really far from what my mom did. So you said childhood meal.
Yep, your favorite childhood meal.
Which is actually like kind of a loaded question for me, because I had like a growth hormone disorder. So I was an extremely picky eater growing up.
Got it.
And the doctors basically told my parents, like, you don't have room to be like... Too bad that's what's for dinner. Mm-hmm. And so basically, like, if a parent had to cave to a shitty kid.
You had the ultimate.
Yeah.
The ultimate yeah. reverse card.
So it was either this or like hot dogs with eggs. So, which I can't eat anymore because it sucks so bad.
I was expecting mac and cheese. The eggs was a total curveball.
I know, like, I like had a horrible taste.
So you just have like two hot dogs with some scrambled eggs or whatever on the side?
No, it was like worse. Well, yeah, it was like cut up hot dogs in scrambled eggs. This is when I was like a toddler. Oof.
Okay, so yeah. It was like the hot dog beans classic mix, but instead of
like
beans.
With eggs and strawberries on the side for some reason. So when I asked my mom, like, oh, what's a childhood meal? She was like... Hot dog, that's all you fucking ate. And I was like, okay, well, that's embarrassing. I can't ask a friend to make that for me. So let's dig deeper.
No, nobody else would have brought hot dogs, strawberries, and eggs
to the
party.
Can you imagine? At least, I mean, if you had, maybe if you like didn't have a thing for mashed potatoes, maybe this would have been better.
I can kind of see. How old were you when you were eating that?
I probably like 2 to 4 or 5.
So... That totally makes sense now, I guess, because you just probably as the toddler liked all of those things.
Right.
And then you were like, okay, just put them all together. Who cares?
Yeah. And I was really...
It's not like a 4-year-old's not thinking about the palate mixture.
No. And like... No. And I, like, every item that we added to the foods that I would eat, because I was like losing weight and doctors were like... Mm-hmm. Fuck, or whatever, like doctors said in the 90s. Every like item.
Fuck,
that
bro, your kid's losing weight.
I assume they're all scrubs related. every item we added to the menu was like a big deal. So like I tried cheeseburgers when I was like 11, and it was like game changing. But like, why did I wait that long? We don't know, you know.
Well, waited that long because as the doctor was saying, fuck.
Yeah. Because the doctor was doing like a smash cut to like a musical montage.
I can't. So that you probably remember your first burger then at 11 years old.
Yeah, it was at Wendy's. It was Wendy's Baconator.
God, that's the. What a great first burger to have.
I know. My dad bullied me. It was really, really great.
He bullied you into having the Baconator?
Yeah, okay. Yeah, into trying it. And then I was like, wait, this is awesome. And he was like, you are so stupid. Or whatever dads say when they're trying to say I love you.
Nah, it's pretty on the nose, that
yeah.
one.
Yeah. But yeah, I think I added steak when I was 12. I almost did steak, but I thought it was really mean to ask you to make me a steak.
So like, no, people have done steak before. It's fine. I've been waiting for the day of like duck foie gras or like some crazy expensive meal. No one's done that.
That's
yet.
Also crazy because if you were a child, like who fucking wants foie gras as a child? You don't understand
exactly.
The,
yeah, it's the same thing as like the 4-year-old with the palate. That's right. The one who wants foie gras. They're not the one that's like strawberries and hot dogs, please.
Yeah, so
my life is a barbecue.
Yeah, so this was my attempt at making something you would like, but I didn't fucking know that you hate That's potatoes. Fine.
It's not potato. It's mashed potato. Because it's the texture thing mm-hmm. of just like. That's the best way I can describe.
No one asked you to make that sound effect.
But that is the best way. My brain kind of melts at the like mushiness sure. of it all. And my mom's. I was talking to her today because she cracked up. I sent her a screenshot and I was like, shepherd's pie has been asked for. And of course, it's a redheaded church singing Irish broad who asked for it.
I'm so sad.
Fastball right down the middle.
I'm such a stereotype.
No, it's so good.
So this is actually super. My mom grew up with super classic shepherd's pie, but this is what she tried to do with like three toddlers or
so
whatever.
So there's three total of you.
Yeah.
Okay. See, so that's
redhead church singing shepherd's pie slinging.
So did everybody have this tiny menu?
No, it was just me.
Okay.
I had like a growth hormone disorder.
Right.
And so I was the only one who got a free pass. Everyone else, because like normal childhood rules, like too bad, that's what for dinner, like try it. But
got it. Okay.
I was like on daily Ensures, which I also did not bring for you or subject you to.
She drinks a boost for breakfast, an inch for dessert.
Literally. That speaking of texture, like that shit is awful.
That's like paste, right?
Yeah, it's like very thick.
Ugh, God.
It's like if mashed potatoes like were sad. But so my mom would just make the potato. It was like it was almost like a DIY like tacos or something. So we'd start with it's totally upside down. You'd start with the potatoes and then just sling a couple hamburger scoops and then like top with peas and cheddar cheese. So
interesting.
It was like,
more bread, like in a wrap or a taco or something?
No.
Or okay. So you would use then the mashed potatoes as the
yeah.
As the blanket, so to speak.
Yeah. So the mashed it's just like mashed potatoes with stuff on it because my mom didn't want to go to all the trouble of like baking and putting it together and stuff.
And it's funny because my mom, when I was talking to her, she said, you love burritos. And that's different to me for whatever reason, because I think you can still see the layers of stuff. The rice is still compact enough instead of, again, just...
Yeah. Yeah, I think rice is different because you see a lot of cultures. Many people have found combining ingredients provides a goodness.
Of course. But for whatever reason, mashed potatoes make my brain melt the same way. Do you remember paper mache?
Yeah.
I cried when we were doing paper mache. I couldn't handle the wet paper. And it just exploded my brain of like, paper shouldn't be wet. Paper shouldn't be wet. This isn't supposed to happen. Why is this paper wet?
Do you have a sound effect for that one?
No, that is the sound effect. It's just my...
just panic.
My brain against a cheese grater as a six-year-old. Just That's like, so why funny. Is this happening?
I didn't even think to do my research of like what Danny doesn't like to eat.
Well, if you had, and then this would have been the perfect one to request.
Oh.
Because this is a running bit of like shepherd's pie, the noise, and all that. So,
sure.
So
well.
There's three of you hanging around.
Mm-hmm.
So five total, mom and dad together.
Yeah.
Again. Okay.
Yeah, together again at last.
So you're the only. So mom did most of the cooking during the week?
I think my mom did like the maintenance cooking. That was bad.
I love that phrase though, maintenance cooking.
Well, because we have to eat so much. It's such a scam.
I have been thinking about this so much lately.
Yeah.
It's an absolute sham that we have to eat three meals a day.
I know, it's crazy.
I live at the grocery store now, having started this podcast and like running out and just getting stuff for myself as well.
Yeah.
I'm at the grocery store so fucking much. It is a goddamn scam
crazy.
The human body requires as many calories as it does.
Literally, as soon as you finish eating whatever you spent hours preparing, your body's already like getting hungry again. It's
what's next?
Up. Yeah,
how
exactly.
many times for breakfast have you been like, "What are we having for dinner tonight?"
Right, and you're like, meal planning takes so much energy. that I totally understand how you get into like recipe ruts or like takeout ruts, because like it takes a lot of activity.
Yeah, menu ruts, like even for yourself, of like Monday we'll do this, Tuesday we'll do that, Wednesday we do
right
whatever. So right. Maintenance cooking was done by mom. That, yeah. We call that Monday to Friday.
Sure. And okay. A lot of, you know, easy meals, a lot of like Stouffer's, because she, I think, went back to school and started trying to get a degree and stuff. And then my dad is the one who will like go above and beyond and like pull out the grill and like do something really fancy. So basically my parents are like a microcosm of like the sexism in the chef industry where women really do more domestic labor, but it's male chefs who are glorified. So
oh no.
But in a good way. If that were good, that would be my parents.
If that were good, that would be my parents. Let's drive down this road a little bit. Should they still be together?
They should. They're having a nice time. They're in Puerto Vallarta right now.
No way.
Yeah. They love to take paradise vacations and just send pictures to the family group chat. Like, it's very... How long to rub it in.
How long have they been together?
Oh, God.
That's...
It's gotta be close to 40 years.
So I think... Because church... I think we had similar upbringings.
Oh, really?
Were you... always singing in church, or were you ever an altar server?
Oh, well, I was singing in church, but I grew up in LDS church, so
it was, oh, like, okay, so I was gonna say that's definitely,
there's like pioneers and stuff.
Okay. Yeah.
missionaries whatever.
It's Latter-day Saints, right?
Yeah.
How is that different from then, because now you're singing in my home field advantage.
Yeah. My mom talks a lot about how like it's crazy that I'm the daughter who's still involved in church, literally this church. But I think I got more out of growing up LDS musically than like sometimes I think about or like realize.
Interesting.
Because they do have a lot of music.
Okay, so it's more of a party in their service.
It's I don't know if I'd say it's a party, but they're, you know, they're hanging out.
Erin comes out, starts dropping bars.
Yeah. And I did always sing in church. Actually the first solo I sang was, do you know that Christmas carol, A Little Town of Bethlehem?
No, hum me a couple bars.
Da, 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 da,
oh, wait. Yeah, wait, okay, yeah.
Yeah, so I sang that
one. I'm a little drummer boy, personally.
Oh, yeah, you're a little Danny the drummer boy?
Nice. My favorite Christmas song actually is Dominic the Donkey. We can get into that later. But
oh, my God.
Okay, so your first solo was...
That. Yep. I sang the first verse when I was, like, four, and someone else covered the rest of it, because reading it was hard. But that, too, it's, like, so weird, and I still don't think about this that much, but the church that I sing at now, Trinity Church Boston... The composer of that tune was the director of music there in the 1800s.
No way.
Yeah, which is like...
Oh, it's like a fun little...
It's kind of cute.
It's a fun full circle moment.
Yeah, so cute.
So wait, 4 years old and you're... What triggered the question here was, you said reading was hard. 4 years old. How did you learn the words then? Did you just hear the song sung to you over and over again?
I don't remember as well as I remember like my first burger, but I I did have like an insanely good memory. Like I memorized the books that my mom would read to me at night. So my guess is that. And I also, I have not thought about this in forever, but I also sang like My Heart Will Go On when I was like four or five at my dance recital.
Wow.
So I don't know. I was learning it.
So
somehow.
You've been singing before you knew how to read.
Yeah. Or how to sing.
Oh,
it was crazy.
And that's, you said before too, like, oh, remember when I used to do comedy? So you're done now. You're just going full singing.
I mean, no. Well, this is so embarrassing. I hate admitting that I enjoyed this, but in Amy Poehler's book, she talks about how like any like industry in the arts, she was talking about like comedy and television, but I think it's like applicable to everything, that it's like this pudding that someone keeps promising you, and it's only as soon as you're like, oh great, I got the pudding, that it gets yanked away again, like over and over. Huh. And that definitely happens in the singing industry, and I think that happens in comedy too. Yeah,
definitely.
Yeah, for sure. It's like you get some momentum going and you're like, oh, okay, cool. And then like a global pandemic happens and you're like, what the heck? You know? Yeah,
or the goalposts just keep moving of like, cool, I got this thing. I've been consistently getting this thing. Now I want this other thing.
Exactly.
You know, which is drive as well. But it's like, you know, there's not a lot of appreciating what you've accomplished.
Right. Yeah. And I think about that. There's a saying that's like, you are exactly where you want it to be. Like, 6 months ago, where you dreamed you would be, which is like super true for gigs or bookings. Yeah. Or it's all kind of similar.
That's a really good phrase. And your story today, I don't think I had my phone up. What did you, anxiety is the outsourcing of...
Oh, the outsourcing of approval?
Yeah. I mean, that is stand-up.
I know, right?
We're outsourcing approval.
Yeah. I was just talking to my boyfriend about this, about is being an artist, does that mean that you just enjoy attention and taking up space? And I think one thing that is different across fields between like singing and comedy that I really liked about stand-up that I miss about it is that you had to earn taking up space, because when you don't earn it, you bomb.
Yeah.
And that's what you should do. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like that's what you deserve to happen. You didn't earn anything. And I wish other art forms were as mean.
As brutal. So what, I mean, I'm sure that there's been singing gigs, though, that you would equate to a comedy bomb.
Yeah, I guess. Not in the same way.
That was the next lead-in of, like, how is it different? Because,
oh, my gosh.
You forget a word or, like, off tune or something. But, like, even to the common non-singer, I can't hear if you're like, oh, fuck, my pitch was a little off there. Like, sure. I can't hear that. Sure, to me, it's still like, oh, shit, she sounds great.
Yeah, I feel like that would be the equivalent of, like, if a musician came to a comedy show. Like, I was talking to a musician, and I was like, oh, like, this bar isn't as great because, like, the ceilings are super high, and so it makes people fit. And he was like, I have never considered that. Like, why would that affect? And I was like, no, it absolutely does. Like, you want low ceilings, you want people packed in, you know, coughing on each other and drunk, and
you want where the pandemic would spread.
Exactly.
That's like
what COVID wants is also what I want.
the worst place for a fire is the best place for a comedy show.
Yes, exactly. So it would, there definitely are craft things, but there also is an air of politeness. So even if you are the equivalent of bombing, let's say you're like super off pitch or super unprepared and don't know your words or whatever, like people will still clap for you. And
yeah, no one in church is gonna be like, boo.
Right, exactly. Especially not at church, not in the Lord's house.
This fucking broad sucks.
I wish they would. See, I think that would be hilarious.
Imagine a heckler from Bill's Bar going to, like, one of those classic hecklers that you see.
I'm going to plant one. That would be great.
Pay him $50 just to be like, fuck this bitch.
Oh, my gosh.
Everyone
looking
at him like,
yeah. So if you have to, in that field, you have to be self-aware enough to bomb. Like, because I've seen it where, like, they don't know that they should be embarrassed about it. Or that they're unprepared or whatever.
Comedy, and music, or both?
Well, yeah. But comedy, I feel like there is such a, like, feedback loop that if you're not getting it, it is sad. But there are people...
There's definitely people who don't
catch that.
Yeah, who don't see the feedback loop is not being completed.
Yeah.
And are like, what's going on? Why can't?
Yeah, so there is a big self-awareness thing in any artistic industry, I guess, where you are the producer of the art. But
are you still up there? Are you doing, so stand up obviously just you, are you up there now again still by yourself? Are you in a choir? Are you
at the church? It's mostly choral stuff.
Okay.
I'm also doing like solo gigs, like I was just in an opera and all sorts of other stuff, so it's all kind of you can be ready for either, you know.
So how do you feel going then from lights on me, you know, jokes, just you, back to like ensemble? Is that the
ensemble?
Right, you know, back to like a group, you know.
I don't even, I guess, think about it that way. So one of the really big differences that I loved about stand-up in particular is that you got to choose what to say. Mm. And they were like, it was your point of view and your thoughts, which meant that like if you bombed, it hurt harder because it was like the audience was like rejecting you.
Yeah.
But choral stuff in my my God, I hope nobody listens to this from choir, but it's literally like a job. So like I am going and I'm like really good at the craft and I am really good at reading and like singing all the notes and, you know, helping others. So we're
why would you not want anyone to hear that from the choral? I think that's
because if it's their art form and like they're like, oh, I love this artistic identity, like you don't want to hear it's just a job, I guess.
Oh, okay. I guess. All right. That's I mean, sure. But I thought it was more what you were saying after of like, you know, I'm good at this, but like that's just confidence. Like, you know, that's you are a important piece then to however 6, 7, 8, whatever, how many people are in the choir.
Yeah.
Regardless of how you view it.
Yeah, totally. And that's our job. So there's
it literally is your job
for like over 60 volunteers. So we sort of like hold down the fort,
right?
You know, but no, I think it actually happened more so in the fact that I had so much experience, like stage presence experience, I guess, that when I went into comedy, people were like, oh my God, she looks so comfortable on stage. Why is like a stream of drivel coming out of her mouth and why is she so confident about it? because that's what people in stand-up are fighting so hard for, 3 minutes of stage time, 4 minutes of stage time, you know, and... It was, so it's like interesting how the skills intersected, I think.
I was gonna say, so you started with, you know, again, 4-year-old singing.
Yeah, I didn't do any 4-year-old stand-up sets.
That's right. So you started stand-up as the adult. So you had all of that time. Did you do like plays too as a kid?
Yeah, I was that kid. I hate admitting it. That's so embarrassing. But yeah, I was like a theater kid.
But again, that totally is why then. You get up on stage to do jokes then, and if you're like, oh, she's drooling, she's selling it though.
Yeah, I did sell my drool in comedy. It was one of the defining facts about me.
So you just did an opera solo gig?
Yeah, we just did a modern opera. It was a comedy, actually. So, oh, you know, in terms of skills intersecting, it's so silly how it keeps happening. But
it is two things you are good at though. So why not combine them?
Yeah.
I mean, you've been humming and whistling like the whole time we've been hanging out already. So,
oh my
like,
God, I'm so sorry.
No. I'm saying that's like a nice thing. Like it's a nice like tune. You're carrying. It's like a nice. Like, clearly, you are musically oriented as well as still having comedic chops. So like, why not try and combine the stuff as much as you can?
Yeah. Oh, totally. I still have it on my resume. I hate to use it since I'm not like. You know, grinding at open mics or anything, but it's such a conversation starter. And
exactly.
It's interesting because even before I did stand up, the only roles I got was they were like, oh, well, you're really funny. So I would get all the comedic. And so I feel like I honed, I don't know. It's interesting. So to answer your question from like 20 minutes ago at this point is I don't really, it's not that I don't do comedy or it's not that I'm fully in singing or any, I'm just sort of like trying to like live artistically. So I'm not living like goalpost to goalpost, if that makes sense.
That totally makes sense. Absolutely. Yeah. And by the way, 20 minutes ago, I didn't, that's how this works, baby. We bop around. My sister a while back was like, do you prepare for these at all? I was like, no, why would I? This is no.
It's, oh my gosh. That's like a Tonight Show segment.
No.
This is like a hangout that's palatable for people.
Yeah, it's literally just to catch up with friends that I haven't seen in a while and trick them into making content also.
Hell, perfect. Yeah, that's great.
It's opera comedy. What was the plot?
I think I've lost the plot like pretty securely at this point. I might have had one and then COVID hit, but I don't know. Yeah,
I meant the plot of the show.
Oh my God,
that's why I cracked up there because you took it so. I was like, "What's the show about?" And you're like, "I got a lot of stuff to think about."
I mean, that plot's pretty hard to follow too. It's modern opera, which like kind of has a stigma of its own. But we got a lot of audience people afterwards being like, "That was so beautiful, spectacular visuals. What was it about?" That new opera, it's called The Thrilling Adventures of Lovelace and Babbage, and we are actually touring it to Michigan in June.
No way!
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah, thank you. So when I say I'm like doing singing, I'm like, well, I got a gig.
That's Yeah, that's a road gig.
Yeah, I'm a roadie.
You're working a road gig, Erin.
It's me and Sam Morrill. We are out there.
Could you imagine Sam Morrill doing fucking opera stuff too?
Oh my god.
Well, Mateo Lane does the opera stuff. Yeah, see? There you go.
There's a couple crossovers.
There's a couple comics who sing opera and do jokes.
Yeah.
You look at you.
That could be. I feel like I did the other end. I'm like better at telling opera jokes now. But so. The Ada Lovelace is the real inventor of like a computer, and she had a mentor named Charles Babbage, who was probably neurodivergent. And what happened was Ada Lovelace like died tragically early of like uterine cancer or something, and she was actually like the function behind their duo. And so the Queen of England actually gave Charles Babbage like enough money for like 2 warships, and she was like, please finish this computer idea. I think they called it the analytical machine or something. And he never did. He was like, thank you so much for the money. And he just like didn't do anything. And it was actually their notes that they looked at when they built the first computer analytical engine. That's what it's called. When they built the first computer in whenever they did that, like the 40s or 50s, they're like looking back at their notes. But so this is like based on a steampunk comic book by an author named Sydney Padua. That's like, what if she didn't die of cancer? And so they go on like a cute little, like, what if they did get to build their analytical engine? And so they go on adventures and do.
What if this guy didn't just get a lot of money for no fucking reason?
Yeah, exactly. He's, and it's the comic book is incredible.
Really?
As far as like media go, it's so cute. And one interesting thing about, not that I'm like plugging this show, I guess I sort of am. Please, I think it's funny.
Yeah. This sounds cool. So like, I'm going to keep asking more questions. So yeah. Like, keep going. Tell us all about it.
One interesting thing is that women weren't allowed to publish books in Victorian England. And so what Ada Lovelace did was she added footnotes. So Victorian women could only add footnotes and like editorial comments to a book of Charles Babbage's, but her footnotes were 3 times as long as his book. And so this comic book is like historical fiction, and so she uses a bunch of footnotes as a like a homage to that, to say like, oh, like Charles Babbage used to keep a gear in his pocket, it was so silly, and like all this stuff, because like that was the only way that Ada Lovelace was allowed to like publish her findings or like do anything. It was like very interesting.
Unreal. Fucking
yeah.
The footnotes is the real book.
Yeah, exactly. It's like
Charles Babbage just fucking hanging on like he's Garfunkel and sign, you know, from
Exactly. And he fucking, was.
Yeah, exactly. It's completely
So the book is, there's this part where like there's an asterisk and you think it's gonna be another footnote, and then she turns it into like another character and the asterisk starts talking back to her, and it's really creative and cute.
Wow.
Highly recommend checking out. It's kind of a cult classic.
Who are you playing then?
So it's just a cast of 4.
You're Charles Babbage, aren't you?
Yeah, I'm sexy Charles Babbage. There's
bumbling hot idiot Charles Babbage. played by the redheaded Irish broad.
So there's Ada Lovelace and Charles Babbage, sure. And then there's basically all the other side characters.
Okay.
And that, so I'm the side character who is all the girls. So I'm the asterisk. Girls because they're hot.
Right.
And I'm like the Queen of England, and I'm Ada's mom, who was also like a mathematician but super dour.
Oh wow, so you gotta do a lot of different characters.
Yeah, it's like a crap ton of costume changes.
Wow, okay. But, and then I'm sure that there's one character you like playing the most.
Yeah, the Queen of England. It's so funny that she sings a whole aria in this opera. The Queen is like very stupid, and it's kind of like a statement on like imperialism and stuff like that. And so I had this for our production in February. I had this huge wedding gown from the 80s covered in Union Jack flags.
Oh.
And then
that
like
cool as hell.
Yeah, it was very funny. And then she is like getting really mad that the analytical engine isn't working, and then it starts working, but it's just spitting out like ASCII pictures of cats. And Ada and Charles are like, we did not tell it to do this. This is not working. And the Queen of England is like, this is amazing. I can't imagine anything better. And I sing this whole aria about cats. And my boyfriend was like, wow, a pompous lady singing about how much she loves cats. What a reach for you.
That's what I was like, right, that is, again,
yeah,
right in your lane.
I know. It's so I sing this weird tango.
Not the pompous part, but the cat-loving part. Sure.
It was, and it's also the best music on the show, which is lucky for me.
It's a tango?
Yeah, it's this, ooh, little, like, kind of, like, double bar tango. The whole thing's in the whole tone scale, which doesn't mean anything to you, but it's very quirky sounding. And, so, yeah, it's very funny and silly. And
I won't ask to sing for you to do that because I'm sure that's the same thing of, like, tell me a joke.
Yeah! Yeah, it would probably sound weird without the accompaniment, too. But I can send you a recording. I have the aria really linked because cool. I like it so much on my website.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Erin Matthews.com.
NicoleMatthews.com. Erin Matthews was taken. She's an middle name. Actor in L.A.
Oh.
She has a reel on YouTube. It's fine.
That's fucking awesome, though. So you're going to Michigan for this?
Twice, I think.
Twice?
Yeah, one time is for a festival and the other time is to a college.
So wait, you have to go there and then back and then.
Yeah. One of them's in June and one of them's in October. Ugh. Yeah. So, oh well.
You're gonna have to drive there?
No, they're flying us out.
Okay.
So, yeah.
There you go.
It's a nice roadie gig. It's a nice roadie gig.
No, you don't have to all cram in a fucking Toyota Highlander together or whatever.
No.
Sleep in the back of it.
No. So, but that's, so that's fun.
That is really cool. I have the imperialistic theme. You said that, you know, it's a modern opera, so it's different. So a lot of people have a stigma about it
because it's weird.
Is that,
yeah?
Isn't all opera kind of weird though?
Yeah. but if you're like an opera fan, you want it to be weird in this one specific way.
Really? Okay. So is this kind of like, is it like old jazz in that sense?
Worse, but yes.
Worse? Interesting. Yeah. Okay.
Oh, yes. And opera fans are all 90 and horrible. And
I guess it's true.
Yeah. But yeah, that same sort of thing where like they're like, no, this is tradition. And even having new pieces is like, why aren't you doing Carmen? Can you just do Carmen again, please?
So how did you then, if you started singing at like 4 or 5 years old, how did you get into the old person music?
I don't know.
Did someone just tell you had a great opera voice? Like, what?
I think I did.
You're like 27 years old. You're the same age as me. 28. Like, how?
I'm 29.
Oh, okay. What's the, oh my God.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. That makes so much sense still for opera.
Well, I think
it's just not something that, you know, typically people gravitate towards.
Totally. I think what happened was there is sort of like an avenue from theater kid and what is called like legit theater singing. So think like Christine from Phantom of the Opera.
Okay.
As opposed to like, nah, or whatever.
Oh, okay. So that is what I think of when like theater kid singing is the like, nah.
Yeah. So I did always like have more of a legit voice. And then I think when you apply that, like I wanted to study music in college and the academic outlet for that, especially with my like theater experience and stuff, because there is concert work, which is actually what I like better now, but there is an avenue for like, oh, okay, I guess it's opera then. And so
it's kind of like Latin.
Is it?
No, I'm saying, is it kind of like Latin? Like, you know how all languages come from Latin?
Oh, in that yeah, sense? Yeah,
so
yeah,
like
yeah.
Opera is everything kind of like step. So if you're going to study music, you should study like the first kinds of music.
Yeah, I would say it is the sort of like erudite peak of music. And so I think I do genuinely think like classical singing is the hardest form of singing. Mm. And so you want to, technique wise, you want to study for the hardest thing. You know, you train for the Olympics and then you can run around the park. That's very debilitating to pop music people. They have a lot of cool stylistic things too, and there's a lot of things that are hard about that too.
No, I thought that was a really cool way of putting it, because like I'm sure the technical aspects of opera is more than just like, you know, throwing a rap banger together or whatever, like,
which I love doing too.
Yeah, I'm sure, yeah, Erin, as you Yeah, you love rapping. The redheaded Irish broad.
Me eating my shepherd's pie. God, I can't wait to rap. Go ahead.
I was just gonna say, like, I'm curious about the technicality of it, because again, the science, you know, there's a lot of technical stuff in comedy too, but a lot of it doesn't, you just say the words. The writing is what the technical part is.
Yeah.
You, I think that's the opposite now, where the singing is the technical part.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess just like, you literally have to train your voice, right? Like,
yeah.
You do mm-hmm. like vocal workouts.
Mm-hmm. Basically.
Can we do one of those now? Because I'm curious.
Do you
want
to do a vocal workout?
I
want
to do a vocal workout.
Oh my God. Like, you want me to walk you through a vocal?
Yeah.
What, oh
yeah,
my
yeah,
God.
Yeah.
Like a warm up?
Yeah.
Well, oh
yeah.
My God. Yeah, I'm obsessed. Okay. Yeah. Can you go? Oh my God. That was beautiful. Those are your falsetto. So you do one lower because you're a boy. Aw, oh, you suck at that one.
That was bad, okay.
I would never do that as a voice teacher.
No, that is too much.
Good, okay, so now...
So like a little horsey.
Yeah, so what that's doing is connecting to your breath support.
Okay.
So then, let's put specific pitches on it. Can you go like...
Like a motorcycle.
Yeah, like a motorcycle. Yeah. No. Pick a note. I liked mine, but you can pick yours too.
If anyone is going to hire Erin for vocal lessons, again, this is not how she will treat you or your child. Or again, if a parent of Erin's students found this is not how she talks to your child.
Oh, God forbid. Oh, my God, no.
Hey, does Erin tell you that you're really bad at this and then say that's fine? I don't. We should stop paying her.
I do think I actually do use comedy pretty well as a voice teacher too, which
I
is
bet too
weird.
Because I'm sure it's a frustrating thing.
I think it's tough and it's a very personal work because it's sort of like comedy in that is your voice.
Yeah.
And so to even take it out and take it apart and kind of work on it, it's like, that was good. Yeah.
I lost it there though.
Okay, try an octave. That might be easier than step. So can you just go, I'll try and do one low enough for you. Can you go?
Nope.
Duh, see, that note right there.
What? Okay, so wait, this is the connecting tissue? What are we doing again?
So, well, there's a lot of things.
Why am
at
I
once.
Being a horsey?
Because we want a breath support.
Okay.
It's hard to get the breath support, but the reason you're having a hard time connecting pitch is that our brain actually uses the vowel of things to help determine like what you're hearing and what it's processing as. And so when you take that away, you're just on, it makes it harder to match pitch. So I bet if I were, can you go like, on that note?
Yeah.
There you go. You're a lot closer. And so you have to train your ear and your voice at the same time.
Wow, that's crazy. I'm trying to put it together. It's like the fucking
I know
it's,
yeah it is like that
thing.
Yeah, I had a voice teacher who described learning voice as fixing a car while you're driving it down the highway, because like everything's like already, which I feel that is kind of the case for stand-up, right? Like you have to get on stage and
also at the same time, like, it's maybe that's like crowd work. I've always described crowd work as like jumping out of a plane,
without
the parachute.
It is like crowd work.
It might, you know, you might land on something pillowy. You might land on some sharp rocks.
Right.
But I think it's different in that sense because the car, you put the car together before the drive.
Sure.
With the writing and the, you know, the practicing the jokes or whatever. You know. So you, in theory, should know how the car runs.
Yeah, and some theories hold up better than others.
Yeah, sometimes.
This is making me think of that Maria Bamford special where she starts with herself in the mirror and then she like does it for her partner and adds their dogs and her parents.
But the parents and
it's cute.
It's a good one.
Yeah.
So, but the fixing it like, because you, as you heard there, I had the adding the. That's the part. That is literally you're driving.
Mm-hmm. And you gotta try and put it together.
Put the gas in while you're going.
Yeah.
Fucking get out, siphon it, whatever.
And I did jump straight into the warm-up part of it with the breath support, so that's kind of a hard ask for your ear. So I could have done something else.
All right, then. Give me another one, then. I'm not gonna get defeated.
okay. Try, Let me try and pick a note.
And also, I just want you. How old are your students? Also,
my oldest one is 84.
Oh wow,
she is so sweet.
That's amazing.
Her. She's a retired Harvard professor. I'm going to her birthday party. I'm so obsessed.
Oh, I just thought that this were like 7 and 8 year olds. That if
I have
were
a lot
here,
of those too.
I was gonna say that if they were here, they'd be like, "Danny, how can you not do this?"
Kids are so good. At, you ask them to make a weird noise, and they're like, "I do that all day." They're like so good at it. Whereas like adults, I had a first lesson with an adult student, and you have to like hype them up to actually sing the first time, which. You'd think that they'd think through, like, oh, it's a singing lesson, I'm going to sing. And they know that as they're doing it. They're like, I knew this was going
to
happen.
You still have to put yourself out there. There's still that wall that has to be broken down.
There's so much baggage for them.
I think singing is maybe the most vulnerable of the art forms.
Totally.
Because you try and sing once and one person makes fun of you, you're never going to fucking sing again.
And you see that? So every adult student has had a story where they were like, I was 11, my choir director said, my friend said, my mom said, you know what I mean? Like, that sticks with you.
I might have told this one. I can't remember if this has come up yet, but this is the perfect layer. So I played hockey in high school. We're all on the bus together driving to a game. And somehow someone just started doing the like, we will rock you, you know, on the bus seats, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
And I just kind of thought at some point we'd all start singing. So I just started and I thought someone like I thought weird, like that was the plan. And I got super made fun of, called like gay, buzzkill, all that. And I sat there so sad for a second. And then it hit me. I was like, wait, we're like 25 minutes from the arena. Were we just going to slap the bus seats the entire time?
You were like, wait, I was right.
Yeah, I was like, wait a minute. No, this is the natural progression of how this should have gone.
So when you say singing, did you start like singing like the verse on your own?
I just kind of thought I think it was the chorus maybe. I don't know. I just thought something would happen. Someone would start. I don't know. I just thought, again, the natural progression would be to stop slapping a bus seat. For already what was going on like a minute and 30 seconds.
I love that if someone's being bullied, I love that like vibe of them being like, no, you're stupid. Yeah, that was right? A bad idea. I'm right.
And of course I didn't have the confidence to stand up and be like, no, you guys are wrong. But now as the adult, I'm like, no, we were all just idiot fucking kids.
Right. Like what was happening? The plan? Kids are such weird social creatures.
You're so right though about like make a weird noise.
Yeah.
The adult is going to be the one that's like, I haven't made a weird noise in 48 years.
Right.
And the kid is like, I got this shit. That's right. Such a great, yeah.
They like don't care. And they don't even, the adults are so acutely aware of what they're doing in the moment, and kids aren't, like they don't even know they're people yet.
They
so
just
like,
don't think about it yet. They're just like, you want totally me to sing? Fine. I'll fucking sing.
Yeah.
And they figure, and then at some point they're like, oh, this is, drop that a little bit, and then, you know, then,
right,
then they can sing in public without being told that they're fucking gay.
Right. Yeah. Unless they, like, want to be, if they identify as, they're welcome to sing.
Oh, that's fine. Yeah.
And have a voice.
That's fine. Yeah. That's fine.
That's such a 90s like school age curse word though. Aughts, yeah.
Oh yeah, I mean we've talked about it a ton here, but like that's the go to for like.
Yeah.
Do you have any boy students? Younger male students.
Yeah.
Have they ever confided in you like, I get kind of made fun of for doing this? Have they?
No.
No.
Well, I had a student, and I think they were non-binary, not when we started studying together, but by the time they left, but because they were so sweet. They were a little bass and they were so cute. But I would say that I get mostly girl students partially because of the stereotyping of it.
Yeah.
And also because like there are male teachers.
Oh, okay.
People still sort of think, oh, like a guy could, which sometimes is true. Yeah. Sometimes it's not, but.
Well, if you have the voice of a little flute, like I did as a young boy.
Oh. Yeah. I bet you would have made a killer boy soprano, Danny.
I used to have to say, hi, this is Danny, who's calling on phones, picking up at my house. Because if I didn't, people would be like, oh, it's Susan, the mother. Or, oh, it's Megan, the older daughter.
Oh my God, that's so cute.
And I would go, no, it's Danny.
That's so sweet.
My mom's got a great voice. She used to sing in a church choir too. So that's why I love hearing about all this stuff. And like,
oh my
how
God.
You start. Yeah. So
yeah.
I... I mean, again, and I enjoy singing, but you have to catch me deep into a boozy karaoke night.
Right. Get that wall down somehow.
Exactly. Because I'm still in that high school bus.
Yeah.
Of being called a buzzkill.
What's your karaoke go-to?
I have a playlist called Go-To Yoki, but my favorite is Teenage Dirtbag by Wheatus.
Oh my god.
Because you can just kind of scream that. You can get away. If you just pick a pop punk song,
right,
everybody screams along with you and you don't actually have to sing.
Oh my god.
So the wall is still up.
Right. Anything to get out of singing.
Exactly.
I feel the same way.
I don't have to. I don't actually have to sing. I can just say like, oh, she hurt me. Like whatever song is on.
Oh my gosh. That's so funny. I vividly remember. So speaking of like traumatizing memories, although this one was more recent. Do you remember when, oh my God, what's his name? He started at the comedy club in like Tennessee.
Sean Carter.
Sean Carter leaving.
Love Sean.
He used to.
Love the club in Tennessee. It's beautiful. Yeah.
Have you been?
I have.
Oh my, it looks so beautiful.
It is. Yeah.
It was like his last open mic that he was hosting at Sally's, which I don't even think there's an open mic there.
Not currently. Oh, unfortunately. But there could be. I've heard rumors that it might be coming back.
Ooh.
But yeah, that's cool. Who knows?
Goss, the hot goss.
yeah, the Monday open mic where you can get a max of 3 minutes.
I know.
It's coming back, baby. We need it.
Sally's was a good one. I was there every week. But, it was a good room. So it was his last one, so it was super popular. So what we ended up doing was going, the bar closed. Mm-hmm. Were you there that night?
I don't think I was, unfortunately.
And so we went over to the comedy studio that was having karaoke night.
Ooh.
And what they did, because there were so many people who were still signed up to go, I don't know why we were like, oh my God, Sean Carter is leaving. I have to do 3 minutes of open mic stand up for him. Like, I guess that's a good tribute. But so they did stand up karaoke song. And I totally bombed at stand up. Horrible. Cause I just started. It was like 2 months in.
Sure.
And then I sang the Shallow song from the Lady Gaga and Bradley Cooper one.
Yeah, yeah.
And then Sean Carter took the mic back and he was like, why don't you just stick to that?
Oh.
And I was like, yeah, why don't I? And then I kept doing stand-up for another, like, year.
Oh, God.
He's so right, though. It was so funny.
No, you should keep doing stand-up because I miss you in the scene.
Aw, I miss the scene all the time. I get along with stand-up people so well. It just, like, I love all the people.
That song is an impressive song to pull off, too. It's a very good song.
Oh, my God, thank you.
With, you know, impressive power.
That's so funny because I feel like the same way about you with like Teenage Dirtbag. Like, you just kind of scream it.
You just scream it. Totally, it's fine. Not, yeah. So what's funny too, I bet Sean the night, you know, he's probably like, I bet a ton of people are going to come. The best open mic send off for an open mic host is on the last one. Don't go to the mic.
Yeah.
Just message them and be like, hey, I appreciate all you've done.
Right, exactly.
The mic can last 20 minutes tonight.
I know. Yeah, exactly. Like, that is like the kindest thing you can do for that. It was like over 100 people long. Yeah. It went to 11. It was crazy.
Yeah, that great showing. I bet everybody thought they were doing the right. I would bet a lot of money that had you previously told Sean, hey, this is going to go till like 11 or, you know, midnight. You're gonna have to host the entire thing. Would you rather no one show up? He'd pick that one.
Oh, absolutely. We didn't even, I don't think I hosted a lot of open mics. I think I covered for like Midway and stuff a couple times, but even at Wet Cat, like hosting a show is like, so like once you're on that side and you're like running things for the scene, it's so different.
Yeah, it's a lot of people are always like, hey, spot, you know, and you know, give me time, and then you have to make sure the show goes well. Yeah. Also, and it's
it goes back to that whole thing of like artists are just kind of taking up space.
Yes.
and the best artists are the ones who do it very considerately, I think, and with a lot of good grounded perspective.
You have said a lot of fantastic blips.
Aww.
That I am going to be chewing on for, I think, multiple days.
Oh my God, I'm so honored.
Yeah. Which is why I was excited to have you over.
Oh my God. That's so sweet. Great.
I think, yeah, this is about 50 minutes. So I think on that little bit, you know, be considerate the fact that you are taking up space.
Yeah, regardless of what form.
Applies to every discipline. Regardless of what form. Yeah. I mean, yeah. Oh my, Jesus, how many people tailgate on the fucking highway and they're like, I'm late. It's like, all right, well, you should have left earlier then.
Like, right, exactly.
Be considerate of other, you know, of the space that you are taking up, because everyone's taking up space.
Totally.
Michigan, please send me that link so I can like put, take, you know, ticket link.
Oh my God, I will.
We do. We've got some Michigan listeners. Shout out to the Michigan listeners.
Oh my God, do we?
Yeah, we got a pretty solid map. Oh, all right. Wow.
Put the Royal Isle Music Festival on your map. We've got a
nice little ball rolling here.
Yeah, awesome.
Please follow Erin Nicole Matthews.com.
Yeah. Or Erin Tar on Instagram.
Or Erin Tar. I'm gonna put all of this in
perfect.
The
perfect. Oh
bio
my God,
anyway.
That's so kind of you.
Follow the show on whatever you're listening to, as well as the Instagram. Erin, thank you so much for dropping some wisdom and telling us all about opera.
Oh my God, thank you for having me. This was so fun.
Bye.